Good morning, good morning. Morning in the overflow room. If you go ahead and come on in, find your seat. Noah is not with us this morning. Noah is actually leading worship at Charter Oak, which is our sister church down in Battleground. So he is blessing them this Sunday, leading worship for them. So this morning you get the Douglas family and Josh. So welcome this morning. Go ahead and stand as we begin worship, and I'd like to open us in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this wonderful opportunity we have to come together as your family. We thank you for this opportunity to have a place to meet. We thank you for our good health. We pray a special blessing on this morning that you'd be with us as we worship, as we learn from your word, and as we fellowship with one another. In Jesus' name, amen.
We will be reading from Romans 8, 15 through 17. For you do not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons.
By whom we cry, Abba, Father.
The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God.
And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. His Spirit washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, and praising my Savior all the day long. And praising my Savior all the day long. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many signs to ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was a I know.
At this time, Angela and Hannah are going to come with our scripture reading.
Today we will be reading from 1 Peter 1, 8 through 12. And though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him now, but believe in him, you greatly rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, obtaining as the outcome of your faith the salvation of your soul.
As to this salvation, the prophets who prophesied of the grace that would come to you made careful searches and inquiries, seeking to know what person or time the Spirit of Christ within them was indicating as he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the glories to follow.
Which part am I reading? I'm late. Just this passage. It was real to them that they were not serving themselves, but you in these things which now have been announced to you through those who preach the gospel to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things look into which angels long to look.
Awesome. Good job, you guys. Awesome. A few announcements for you. First off, I just want to say thank you to all of our, this is kind of a weird title. I don't know if this is a title anybody wants, but they're COVID volunteers. Since this whole COVID thing has happened, we've needed quite a few. It's almost like we've had to reinvent a lot of things and be innovative, and there's been a lot of folks. It takes quite a bit to turn over the service from first to second. Every surface that you're sitting on has been cleaned, believe it or not. And sanitized appropriately. There's the greeters that show up to help out. I mean, there's just lots of stuff that is done. And so just a huge thank you to all of those of you. I could name names, but I definitely would miss some, as well as just to the children's workers who prep the bags with the lessons for the kids so that they can have those. So anyway, just thank you so much for all of you that do so much. Also, for those of you who were not here last week, the challenge to you as a church, if this is your church, if this is where you attend regularly, the challenge is to memorize Romans chapter 8, the whole chapter, before the end of this year. No problem. I've heard from a number of you how easy it is to memorize. But that's why you've got until the end of the year. That's a ways out, right? If you like do three words a day and forget a week, you still are only not behind by more than a verse. So just stick with it. It's encouraging to hear those that are in that process first of memorizing this. So it's something we want to do as a church, not just a few, but all of us. So those of you in middle school and high school, challenge your friends to do this. Make it more important than your next post, next social media presence. Challenge you in your growth groups, in your personal lives, in your families, especially parents of young children. Lean on your kids who are better memorizers than you. But take that seriously, that challenge. And also, we had a business meeting last week. Woohoo! A business meeting. It was great. It was a good business meeting. Good turnout for that. But it was also, I've had a number of people ask me if we recorded it. We did. It's video recorded. It's on our church website. And there's a password to get in because we talk financials and things. And if this is your church home, all you have to do is you'll either get a letter or you can call the office and get that password. I'm not going to give it out here because this goes out on the interweb or something like that. But this is if this is your church home, then you can give the office a call and log on because it is a riveting 1 hour. It was a pretty good. The only problem is you're not going to get a chance to taste the ice cream that we ate at the end. Ha ha. Too bad you missed out last week. But anyway, last thing I'll mention, it's been a busy week in my family in the sense that I have, almost 4 people in my family that have had birthdays this past week. My son Liam turned 19 on Thursday. Is that right? Something like that. My mother-in-law, I won't tell her age, but my mother-in-law's birthday. Well, I didn't hear you, Dad. All right. For those of you in the overflow chapel area, there might have been an incident of battery in here when he yelled out the age. But my brother-in-law, and more importantly, my elk hunting partner, John, is here today, and it was his birthday yesterday. And then the other one that really makes our lives easy as staff here is Carrie. Carrie, it's her birthday today. As well, she happens to be celebrating with her family up in Seattle area, so she's not here. Who have I missed in the room this size or the overflow room? Oh, Mike and Anna. Who is this? Anna's? Yeah, the fact that Anna's hiding her face from us. Okay, good. The mother-to-be here shortly. All right. Do you have anything else to say, Anna? All right. Well, as we do sometimes, someone else can open up and sing happy birthday. We'll do it right now. Happy birthday. Nice. Good job. Okay, two other quick announcements before you grab some coffee, and then we'll be back and jumping into Romans 8 again. First off, now I don't know how to actually give this announcement. It was Nancy Tester asked me to thank whoever it was that sent her a card with a scripture written on it and signed Jesus. So she wanted me to make sure she said thank you, but I kind of like, it's signed by Jesus. So, I mean, are we thanking Jesus? That's what we're doing, right? We're thanking Jesus for shining through one of your hands and hearts that thought of her this week. It meant a great deal to her and made her cry. So feel good about that. We love you, Nancy. And then also, last thing I'll mention, there is a backyard garden tea at Sherry Eddy's house. It's being put on by Sandra Fernandy, our missions chair, and Sherry Eddy. And the proceeds for this benefit are going to be split between two different projects. I don't have all of the details, but I'm just mentioning it. And now there'll be more announcements. It's on the 21st and 22nd at both 11:30 and 1. There's tables for 6 and 3. I'm not going to say anymore. It's a tea. And it should be great. And so anyway, keep an eye out for more. The proceeds will go to a couple of great causes. And it's been something they've done similar things like this every year. But with COVID, it's been changed up a little bit this year. All right. I feel like I'm missing something. I hate when I feel like I'm missing something. But we'll just hi, Valerie.
Hi. Can we just say a quick word about
okay. We'll say that briefly now. We're asking the Lord for volunteers to help take leadership for our annual outreach in the Harvest Party, as well as someone to take ownership of Sundays in a Box. And so be praying about that, and we'll give a little bit more details as to what that is to in future weeks. So, all right, we're going to go to prayer before I release you. Our missionaries of the month, Carol Johnson with Global Fingerprints. It was founded in 2006 to help orphans stricken with AIDS in the Republic of Congo, and it's since expanded to reach any orphan in need, especially in poverty-stricken areas. And so Carol Johnson's the representative for our denomination, so we will be praying for Carol this month as she goes about and represents that mission. And then also our family of the month is, a prayer family of the week, is the Gomes family, and so we will pray for them. So join me in prayer before we dismiss. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for the gift of being together as your church family. Lord, we thank you for the gift of gathering, and we also thank you for the gift of your Spirit. Lord, we pray for the indwelling power of your Spirit in the life of Carol Johnson as she represents this important mission to children in need, especially orphans. We also pray for her as she cares for ailing parents, and we just pray for her in advance. And Lord, we also think of the Gome family, and we thank you for Matt and Joy and Nathaniel. We pray that you would bless them as they are busy with work. We pray, Lord, that the things in which they have their hands busy with would be things in which would point them more and more and conform them more and more to the image of Christ. Give them wisdom as they raise Nathaniel and interact with a lot of people up at Campers Hideaway. Give them grace and patience as well. We love you. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Okay, we'll just take about 5 minutes, coffee. We'll be back here, Romans 8. All right, all right, all right. As you're settling into your seats, I was in a conversation this week with a friend, and we got to start talking about something we haven't got to talk about, sadly, for about the last, 10 or 11 months, and I just say with joy that I can say as of today, elk hunting archery season starts next month. So it's coming next month, and with this friend, that's right, priorities, you bet. So this month, we were talking about this, and so we, of course, it's just kind of like fish stories. You start telling hunting stories, and so it came about that my dad had shot a number of years ago a record-sized bull elk in a particular unit in Wyoming. It was a beautiful, beautiful bull that he harvested. And so my buddy asked, he says, well, can I see a picture of it? And so I shoot Dad a text. Say, hey, Dad, can you send a picture of Bruce? He's named, I mean, all of us name our trophies. And Bruce is the name of his. And so those of us who have trophies. All of a sudden my phone dings and I'm able to show my friend this picture of Bruce. And he's just like, whoa, you know, it's amazing. And then as I pull it back, my phone dings like 3, 4, 5 times in a row. Ding, 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 ding. And I look, and Dad has sent me 5 or 6 more pictures of this elk that's hanging on his wall from every particular angle that you could probably, you could see it. And that was fun of Dad to send that to him. And then we went from talking about animals that have passed away to animals that are living and pets. And so now we got talking about my parents and their pet dog, Chester. My siblings and I and the extended family are a little bit jealous of Chester. We call Chester Sir Chester. He's a Shih Tzu dog, and we see how my mom treated us very well growing up, but my dad was just a little bit more intense. He came to first service, so this illustration was very fun in first service, but he was pretty intense, and it's nauseating to see how he treats Sir Chester. And I just think, where was that when I was growing up, you know? And so we're all a little bit jealous of Sir Chester, and then my buddy says, man, would your parents adopt me? I mean, your dad, Elkhan's, and man, he treats Chester so well, and I mean, that'd be great. So he says, your parents would adopt me? And I said, no. You have to understand, it's not all it's cracked up to be. My mom's wonderful, but watch this. And so Dad walked right into this. I said, Dad, can you send me some pictures of me? Silence. No response, no ding, 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 ding. And a few minutes later, what happens? Some text, no picture, pops in. Sorry, I'm not at home, but I've got some there, and I'll send them when I get home. He didn't know that he walked right into my trap. And I said, see, it's not all it's cracked up to be. You don't want to be adopted by him. But the reality, the truth is, we have an awesome, blessed relationship with my parents. And also, that it always is interesting how the Lord brings conversations into sermons. You have to be careful when you talk to me during the course of a week. But in this particular case, the text today that we're dealing with in Romans 8, Paul begins to introduce one of the most beautiful of all doctrines. It's the doctrine of adoption and the spirit of that particular position that those who have trusted Christ have as adopted children of God, and specifically having the spirit of adoption. And so we're going to look at that, that beautiful picture today as we go through verses 15 through 17 of Romans 8. And it says this. Verse 15, for you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, and as we talked last week, as daughters, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. Just pause for a moment to pray. Father, I just thank you so much that you are our Father, and you're a good Father. You're our Abba, Father. We thank you for the opportunity we have to subject ourselves, to submit ourselves to your living word and your living spirit that's been made possible by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. We love you. We pray this in his name. Amen. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons by whom we cry, Abba, Father. It's a great, great term. That word Abba is Aramaic for dada, daddy. And what's interesting is that almost in every language, probably in every language, there is a term very similar to this, dada. In Indonesian, the word is bapa, bapa. In Spanish, it's papa, papa, papa. Turkish, it's baba. And the list can go on. Abba, Father, Dada. And who is it that uses those terms most regularly? Or even will make those terms up on their own? Little kids. Toddlers, kiddos. Why? Why do they do that? They do it because we are made in the image of God. And we want nothing more than to, at the deepest soul level, to feel the warmth and love and acceptance and grace dumped into our hearts. More beautiful than Multnomah Falls dumps water over an edge and it cascades down to the bottom. That is what the human heart longs for, this acceptance and this love, this perfect care. And so it says here, for those who are in Christ, their spirit cries out to Abba, Father, yearning Abba. The interesting thing about this is that even if you did not have the best earthly father, you still have the opportunity to feel this. And even good dads will let us down from time to time. Sadly, though, all humans have this deep yearning, whether they admit it or not. However, we try to make this filled in other ways. We try to find security and fulfillment in a relationship. We find it in trying to have a good reputation and financial security. There's all different ways we seek to try and fill this yearning for the thing in which only can come to the human soul through the Spirit. And so we look at this, but Paul says this. There's only one answer to this. And what you're yearning for is Christ. Christ. That's what you're yearning for. And when you, as he's been saying, are justified by Christ, when you place your faith in him, and you trust him rather than your own deeds, there are some repercussions. There are some ramifications of that. And it is awesome. And it tells us here, what does it do? It releases us. It releases us from a spirit of slavery to a spirit of life and a spirit of peace. So practically speaking, when we talk about the spirit of slavery, because this is important to be very practical, because there are a lot of people that are enslaved. They're enslaved in this world. And we will review what we talked about last week. Jesus was tempted by Satan in three very clear ways. And those clear ways we see here. The first one is in hedonism. And so the enemy of the soul is always going to be tempting individuals to find satisfaction in pleasure, sensual pleasure. What can I get for myself? How can I feel good about my, that's the goal that the enemy would want. So there's this hedonistic temptation. The next one is egotism. Egotism. So egotism is where we find satisfaction by building ourselves up. Our own self is what fills us up. And this is where all of those nauseating cliches come from. Follow your heart. Everything else in our culture, I mentioned it last week. It's a long I-5. It says, live your best life. There are no accidents. You are perfect just the way you are. Now, here's the deal. Those aren't untrue. However, when you look at, let's just take, again, for example, that sign along I-5, since it was probably expensive, and we might as well give them some airtime, right? Live your best life. We cannot live our best life if we have not first died our best death. Because the gospel of Christ Jesus calls us to that place of surrendering our life to Christ so that the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit, can indwell us so that our best life is being lived. If you have trusted Christ, you are living your best life. It may not look like it because we tend to nibble our way lost as sheep. However, we are in Christ living our best life. And so to get a message like that, to think that, well, I'm going to, as a non-believing person who doesn't have the Spirit of God in me, I read a sign like that and it kind of encouraged me. So I'm going to try hard today. Yeah, I can do this because, you know, I'm real nice and, by golly, people like me. You know, I can pull myself up by my bootstraps. But that's not the Christian message. The Christian message is one of emptying of self so that we can be full of the Spirit. However, we're too encumbered by hedonism, our pleasures, egotism, our self. And then the last one is materialism. Materialism, this is where stuff is what brings satisfaction to our souls. Stuff like tools and toys and motorcycles and instrument. Guns was the next one on my list. Big elk trophies, the perfect yard, the perfect property, a piece of technology, a metal lathe, a tractor, and none of those are from my own personal life. But just to recap this here, what is the spirit of slavery practically? The spirit of slavery is any time we seek soul satisfaction from anything else in life, pleasure, self, stuff, outside of the waterfall of Christ's love and acceptance for us that is ours because we've been adopted as his children. Now, really close, as we saw, I'll bounce back here, as we saw in verse 15, there's always something that seems to couple with slavery. There's a slavery, the slavery to stuff and to self and to pleasure, and it seems to always be linked or connected with fear. So we have this need to fill our soul with these things that only Christ can fill, and when those things aren't fulfilled, we can very quickly slip into a spirit of fear. very close to what it's talking about here, the spirit of slavery. And this can sound like, I'm just not enough when I look in the mirror. I haven't done enough. I've made too many mistakes. I've asked forgiveness from God or from somebody else so many times. I can't do this. And so am I going to ever be approved? What do I need? Do I need to live a perfect life every day in order for God to love me perfectly? When bad things happen, and I don't know about you, but in my life, this is a weird world. I was just told during just the break that now the protesters are burning Bibles in downtown Portland. And man, how sad is that? And what a reflection of some other horrific events in history that's mirrored. However, I look at this, and I can say, man, is life going to unravel? What scares me, and I just want to say for us as a church and the body of Christ as a whole, is what I just observe in my own heart and also in talking with some of you, is that we have this idea, it seems like, that most of what we're thinking and saying as it relates to all of this protesting and COVID craziness, all of these things, we're acting as if we are in bondage to fear. That somehow, by what's going on, everything's out of control and unraveling. And I'm telling you, I hear so many justifications for why it's okay. Why it's okay and why we should do certain things. And I have no problem standing up for efforts and drawing lines in the sand. As a matter of fact, I get excited about opportunities for real, true persecution and opposition as it comes. However, what scares me is that what's way more destructive, or I would say way more toxic to the soul of us as those that have been adopted, what's way more toxic to us is the fact that we think and we fear what the opposite political party is doing to what our belief is. And we seem captivated by fear, or maybe even worse than fear, just utter anger. And it's not coming from a place of adoption, a place of peace, a place of joy. It's coming from a place of fear and anger and fetid upness, if that's a word. That's the concern. Our concern, the greatest danger isn't that cause. The greatest danger is getting our eyes off of Christ. The greatest danger is fighting this with our flesh, having the best argument. That's the greatest danger. That's the greatest danger. Verse 16 says this: the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. How does the Spirit do this? How does the Spirit bear witness with our spirit that we are? This is what we talked about for two whole weeks. We talked about assurance, the assurance that we are God's children. What does this mean? How does the Spirit testify? What does the Spirit testify? And again, this is the key to biblical interpretation, is understanding the context. Far too many goofy stuff goes on in the Christian church because people cherry pick verses and then they build teachings, especially around the Holy Spirit. However, with this particularly, what does the context tell us? What is the Spirit testifying to? What is the goal for the Spirit? And we told you last week, and again, we'll say it this week. The Spirit's goal, the Spirit's focus is one and singular, the fact that he wants you and I to become like his Son, Jesus Christ. He wants to mold us into the image of our Savior. That is the bottom line destiny that is ours. He wants that to be more and more a part of who we are. And it's this weird world that we live in. It's this weird world that we live in where it's all God, and yet we still have responsibility. But we can't fulfill our responsibility unless it's all God. How do those two things justify, rectify? How do those fit together? It's a difficult thing, but the Spirit himself bears witness. And so what we can say, we've seen earlier in Romans 8, our job is to think on the things that the Spirit thinks on. Our job is to wash and renew our hearts and our minds with the things that the Spirit thinks on. And we know what the Spirit thinks on. The Spirit's all consumed with the glory of God. The Spirit's all consumed with Jesus being made famous. The Spirit's all consumed with the love of the gospel going out through us as his children, as his church, to be equipped to take this message of hope and restoration and what real love is to a world around us. That's what the Spirit, his goal is for us. And our spirit, as it's in partnership with his, it witnesses beautifully. And it gives an assurance that cannot be unshackled from our hearts. So it gives us the ability to have this changed life. It gives us the ability to let the fruit of the Spirit spring forth from our life. Love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. These aren't things that we try harder to do. These are things that we stop trying to do. We rip open our chest and we allow the Holy Spirit to come in and say, I am yours. And when we do that, the Holy Spirit's the one that bears fruit. And so when the fruit of the Spirit is evident in our life, the Spirit is, that's a Spirit-driven life. That's what it means to be filled with the Spirit, to walk in the Spirit. It might look some other different ways, but if it doesn't encompass that, it's just mumbo jumbo. Verse 17 says this. First part of it says this. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God, fellow heirs with Christ. If children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ. It's one of the reasons why we have to go through Romans, and we go through expositively, verse by verse, and why we've slowed down, just because the depth and the richness and the meat in these words is just awesome, and if we try to put too much of it in one sermon, there's too much to be missed. I feel like I'm already missing some stuff, but this is where we can talk a little bit about adoption. In order to properly understand adoption, we have to understand what adoption was back in the Roman culture when, through the Holy Spirit, Paul penned these words. So basically put like this, in Roman culture, an adopted child was adopted into a family, and when that happened, they had all of the privileges of what would be considered a natural born child. So there's these four steps that had to take place in order for adoption to be legal in the Roman government, the Roman culture. The first one is that the adopted child was completely and totally severed off from any of their previous relationships. There was no any more legal standing or social standing, relational standing with any of their previous family. None, period. Would be what we call today a closed adoption. The second thing is he or she was permanently, there is but they were permanently, irrevocably placed into that new family. Could not be changed. Thirdly, the adopted child was given and had all of their previous, if there came with previous debts, all of those debts or any other obligations were 100% removed, gone, when they were adopted. And fourthly, this transaction was completed in a Roman courtroom with a minimum of 7 witnesses who could testify, if necessary, to any challenge of the adoption after the passing of, especially the father. And I guess the point here, what we're saying here, is being adopted in that culture, being adopted means that you get to possess and you become complete heirs, not partial, but complete heirs with the family. Complete, not partial, complete, and it can't be revoked. I have a dear friend. He and I meet twice a month. He's a pastor out in the east side of the county, and he and his wife felt the Lord calling them to adopt. And I don't know. I don't think I've ever said this before, but there's nothing more beautiful than if that's what the Lord is leading you to do. Have you ever asked the Lord if he's leading you to adopt? I don't know. If you haven't, maybe you should ask the Lord that. But they felt led to adopt a child, and with this adoption, they found a child. The Lord worked it all out from a really depressed country on the other side of the world. And this particular child was severely neglected and horrifically tortured and left for dead as a very young, almost just a little more than a toddler. And so they adopted this child. They spent thousands and thousands of dollars. They sold stuff that, you know, was there for there for their pleasure and their materialistic desires. They sold all that stuff. They went and they picked up this child across the world, and they brought this child home. Now, every few weeks when I get together, this happened 4 years ago when the adoption went through. Every few weeks when I get together with this friend, he is exhausted. He looks so tired. And what's interesting about him being so tired, their daughter, every single night since they brought her home, wakes up with night terrors, reliving her past. And at first, especially, she knew no English. And even now, especially then, but even now, while they go in, they wake up, they run in to see what's going on, and they both of them will bring her comfort. They try to wrap their arms around her. They try to calm her down, and she will bite and fight and spit at and repel them, push them away. And just thinking about that makes me sad, because she's missing out on the warmth that they're offering her and the love that they're offering her. But then also thinking about that, I just think that is me, and that is you. We are that adopted little child. When we live outside of this Romans 8 message, when we try to, with our own best efforts, live our best life apart from the Spirit's empowerment, when we think that by preaching a message or doing our devotions every day or even memorizing Romans 8 perfectly, somehow, some way, that is going to be what finally salves the slavery I have to self, or finally salves that slavery of fear that then God will accept me. But what happens when you go a week and you forget that verse? There's other ways that we go about and go after and try to fill and push away. But I'll tell you, the great thing about this, and I haven't asked this question because I don't need to ask, I know the answer. But if my friends were asked, and even when they talk about their sweet little girl, there is zero distinction between this girl and any of their other, we'll just say, natural born children. There's no difference whatsoever. Actually, I'll just, as a tip for us as a congregation, just a teaching tool, if you're ever talking with adoptive parents, please don't ask the question when they're talking about an adoptive child, how many of your own children do you have? That's a common question. I made that mistake, and because of a family here, I've learned the error and the hurt that causes. Because adoption is beautiful, and we are adoptive, and yet, while we were still sinning, Christ died for us. While we were still biting and screaming and pushing back, and even while now that we're redeemed saints and we've trusted Christ, we still can oftentimes live like we're pushing back and biting and screaming, because we bought into, even though we're saved and we've trusted Christ, we don't have the assurance of Christ because we've grieved the Spirit of Christ, because our life is filled with messages that are not of Christ. And we bite and we scream and we push back. So, we are co-heirs with Christ. All that Christ has is ours. Even if we push back, even if we struggle to remember it, even if we forget it from day to day. This is why it's important for us to memorize Romans 8, why it's important for us to gather as Christ's church, to submit ourselves to his living word, to look at one another in our eyes. They haven't covered our eyes up yet, nor will they. We look at each other and we love each other. This is the church. This is what we are called to do. We are so gifted at forgetting about this message of the cross. And what scares me to death is that this little bit of restrictions that come our way, and it gives many Christians excuses to disconnect from other believers. And I'm hearing stories left and right about those that are falling away, that are drinking the Kool-Aid, and it's hard, because this is the deal. This is nothing. What we are facing as a culture right now is nothing. Even for our brothers and sisters who live downtown and have to see outside their window the nastiness going on by protesters, it's still nothing compared to what our brothers and sisters around the world are, who are still getting killed every single day because someone says, "Do you love Jesus?" And they say yes, and they get shot. This is a persecution that we're trying to keep from coming this way, but we know the story. We know the end of the story, don't we? And that story tells us where this is going. And with that, what are we enslaved to? Are we enslaved to a spirit of life and peace? Or are we enslaved to a spirit of fear and death, a spirit of fear and anger? And this is so important because of where Paul goes. It's another hard part sometimes, but the best part about going through Scripture, a verse at a time, and taking the context is we can't skip over this last verse because it'd be very tempting to stop right here and just say, "You are, and I am, co-heirs with Christ, and all that he has is ours because we've trusted him." But, provided we suffer with him, it says. Provided we suffer with him in order that we also may be glorified with him. Paul is pointing to what's coming next. He's pointing to this. He's telling us that there's suffering to come. If you're a Christian, this is part of your destiny, is to be persecuted. It's part of your destiny to be unpopular and to not have any thumbs up on your posts and to be discounted and denied by your closest friends because you stand up for the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ and you refuse to buy into the hedonistic, egotistic, materialistic, fear-driven slavery that is all around us today. But what Paul's saying is this. And what he's asking, I think the natural question that comes from this, as you think about this, you know, all of these things are provided we suffer with him. Provided we suffer with him. Again, that kind of just doesn't seem to fit with live your best life. Unless my best life is lived with the power of the Spirit and the suffering that comes with identifying with Christ. And I ask you this question, it's kind of a closing question as we go into communion. Is he worth it? Is he worth it? Do you see yourself as that adopted child who's kicking and screaming and fighting against the ever-present, what some might would say even reckless love of God that is always pursuing you? Is it worth it if you have to face tough times and difficulties? I'm scared to think that for some of us, because myself included, we live in such a comfortable world in America, that we're going to step into a spirit of fear and a spirit of anger and to a place in which we're not driven by the Holy Spirit. We're driven by those things, those bondages. We might cloak them with other stuff. Now, is he worth it? And I think you and I both know, yeah, he is 100%. That's why we're here. And that's also why we need the reminder of like communion, because we all fall short of the glory of God. It seems like that's said somewhere else in Romans, right? We all fall short of the glory of God. I was talking to someone in our congregation 2 weeks ago who's suffered probably what I would say is the most difficult of all human sufferings in their life. And it was interesting to talk with this person and to see the depth of peace in their soul. And they were reaching out to serve and comfort somebody else. And they said, you know, I can't explain it, but the comfort and the presence of Jesus and his Spirit has been so near me through all of this. And it makes me sad that those who... It makes me sad that there's others that haven't gone through the hard things that the Lord's allowed me to go through, because it seems like they're missing the love and the joy and the peace that comes only from the assurance of being an heir with Christ, and having the spirit of adoption in our life. I'll have the worship team come up, or Liam and Libs are going to sing a song. We're going to go to a time of communion, and what a great time it is to go to communion. There are in the chapel, there's communion cups up front. There's also communion cups on both sides. In a moment, when I step down, would invite those of you who have trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord to go up and to take a cup. And this is such a great time, as any time is, to remember that we are nothing without the shed blood of Christ, and we need the daily forgiveness for our embondaged slaveries to stuff and to self and to pleasures and to fear. What a great time it is. I'd ask that you don't participate unless you're able to confess and repent of that sin right now, whatever the Lord might bring to your own heart and mind. And if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, you're just basically, this is your chance to do that, to trust him with all of your life. Romans 10:9 says, confess with your heart Jesus is Lord and believe. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead and you will be saved. If you've never trusted Christ, I challenge you to take that seriously, to recognize the beauty that comes only by way of his shed blood on the cross as we celebrate this. So take some time to reflect, and as you are led, you can go grab your elements and come back to your seat, and we will participate in those together. I will give one point of clarification. With those cups, no one likes them. And so what I ask is that we're trying to be good stewards. When all this started and we had to reimagine what it was going to be like to do church, I had Gary order a whole bunch because they were hard to come by. And we're going to finish them, even though they don't maybe taste as good and they're really difficult to open. But our women's ministry is so gracious. Tandy spent a bunch of time peeling up the layers so that you don't have to fight with them this month. And so as soon as you get them and as you're reflecting, don't let it distract you too much. Start the peeling process that's already been started for you. That way, when it comes time to look again at our Lord's Supper directives, you won't be confused by that. And we probably got 2 months more supply. So if you don't like it, just get used to it. So, all right, I'll give you some time to reflect.
Mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend, the agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Wash away my sin, Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied, Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, soul, I want.
Jesus, wash away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The rest of the worship team come up now. I'd like to invite you to stand for the singing of our final song, and what a great and appropriate song it is. And so I do hope, even though it hasn't happened in our state yet, we haven't been told we can't sing, at least I haven't heard that. Well, Scripture is very clear. Scripture does tell us that we're commanded to sing songs, hymns, spiritual songs, and so even if you aren't a musical folk and that's not your preference, I do still think there is a reason why the Lord has given us the command to sing the truth of Scripture one to another, to get our eyes focused on Him and His work. And there's something beautiful about the truths of our faith that seem to stick with the melody. And so what I ask is that as we close with this last song, you sing it with all of your heart. And don't worry about the tune or staying on pitch or whatever. No big deal. So we'll do that as we sing this final song.
Found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still and striving cease. My comforter, alone, you took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God is satisfied. There in the ground is fire.
day. Up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. And no power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home,
Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin and death. You are dismissed. If you'd like prayer, feel free to grab somebody or come grab me. Have a great day.